I'm already chosen. I know who I am. already loved more than I could imagine, yeah, and that is enough. I'm already loved, I'm already chosen, I know who I am, I know what you've spoken, I'm already loved.
Do you believe it, church?
Yeah.
Our God is enough, forever enough.
Yeah. With thee dressed as the lilies, with beauty and splendor, how much more will he clothe you? How much more will he clothe you? If he watches over every sparrow, how much more does he love you? How much more does he love you? If he dresses the lilies with beauty and splendor, how much more will he clothe you? How much more will he clothe you? If he watches over every sparrow, how much more does he love you? How much more does he love you? Jireh, you are enough. Jireh, you are enough. And I will be content in every circumstance. Jireh, you are enough. Jireh, you are enough.
Amen. Our God is enough. He's more than enough. He's worthy of our praise. All together, let's say this. He himself has said, I will never leave you or forsake you. Therefore, you may boldly say, the Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can man do to me? Blessed be the God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to his great mercy. He has given us a new birth into a living hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, uncorrupted, and unfading, kept in heaven for you who are being protected by God's power through faith for a salvation that is ready to be revealed in the last time. No one can lay any other foundation than what has been laid, that is, Jesus Christ. Now firm the foundation, ye saints of the Lord, it is laid for your faith in his excellent word. What more can he say than to you he has said? To you who for refuge to Jesus have fled. Fear not, I am with thee, nor be not dismayed, for I am thy God, and will still give thee aid. I'll strengthen thee, help thee, and cause thee to stand, upheld by my righteous omnipotent hand. When through fiery trials thy pathway shall lie, my grace also.
If you have felt the dark of night, questioning what is out of sight, He is the answer, He is the light. If you have felt the weight of sin, bound by the shame that's hemmed you in, He'll break the chains, He will forgive. Lift your head. Morning is coming, there's more to the story. Don't forget. In green and glory, still great is His faithfulness. If you felt broken and betrayed, no one to trust, alone, afraid, He'll comfort you, He knows your name. If you've wrestled with the ache of loss, and why this has been your present helper, keeper. Great is His faithfulness, perfect, sovereign, fortress. Great.
Sings my soul, my Savior.
We thank you for your goodness, for your grace, for your love, for your faithfulness. And Father, you're always with us. You will never leave or forsake us. We thank you for sending your Son, Jesus Christ, to die for us that we might have a restored relationship with you. That we might receive the Holy Spirit. Lord, you are in us. Lord, you are with us each at every step of the way through our life. Through the hills, through the valleys, through the good times, through the bad times. You are with us and you love us. Heavenly Father, I just pray today that your Spirit would move in each heart here. That you would be seen. That you would be known, that we would be changed, that we would be transformed and have a desire to follow you, to follow your Son, Jesus Christ, more. May Father lift up Pastor Chris. Pray that your words be heard. Lord, that he would fade away and that you would be seen. My Father, I lift up anyone who is here that has not yet put their trust in you and doesn't yet have the hope that we have. I pray that you would draw them to yourself, Lord. They would come to know you, to trust in you, to follow your Son, Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, we praise you. We thank you. For all that you do, pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Then sings my soul, my Savior God to me.
Instead of trying to out for all of those that were going to be affected by this, their plan was to just simply kill the prisoners that were on board. But the centurion that was in charge of Paul stopped this from happening. And let's be honest, it wasn't the centurion that stopped this from happening. It was God's plan.
Amen.
It was God using the centurion to stop this from happening.
Amen.
But he told them to jump overboard and swim to safety if they could, and if they couldn't swim, find whatever they could to float to safety. And they made it to shore. And roughly about 275, 276 on the boat made it to shore. Why did they make it to shore? Because God was protecting them. He said he would, and he did. In the midst of this storm, God was there. And see, this is where we pick up in chapter 28, and this is the last chapter of Acts. I'm kind of bummed, to be honest with you. It's our last chapter that we're going to be looking at together this week and next week. And we're going to look at the first portion of this chapter together. And our story continues, and it continues on the island of Malta. That's where we are. See, God's protective hand was clearly on his servant. And it's seen throughout this entire chapter, as it's been over the last several chapters throughout this book that we have looked at together. And one of the most important things that you and I can take from this is this point. That God's protective plan, hand is on you and I through the trials and through the storms of life, even when we look at these and we think they're severe.
Amen.
God is with us. He is there.
Hallelujah.
So this morning, let's look at Acts chapter 28, verses 1 through 15. And this morning, let's stand together in the honor of the reading of God's word. Says this: after we were brought safely through, we then learned that the island was called Malta. The native people showed us unusual kindness, for they kindled a fire and welcomed us all because it had begun to rain and was cold. When Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and put them on the fire, a viper came out because of the heat and fastened on his hand. When the native people saw the creature hanging from his hand, they said to one another, "No doubt this man is a murderer. Though he has escaped from the sea, justice has not allowed him to live." He, however, shook off the creature into the fire and suffered no harm. They were waiting for him to swell up or suddenly fall down dead. But when they had waited a long time and saw no misfortune come to him, they changed their minds and said that he was a god. Now, in the neighborhood of that place were lands belonging to the chief man of the island named Publius, who received us and entertained us hospitably for 3 days. It happened that the father Publius lay sick with fever and dysentery. And Paul visited him and prayed, and putting his hands on him, healed him. And when this had taken place, the rest of the people on the island who had diseases also came and were cured. They also honored us greatly. And when we were about to sail, they put on board whatever we needed. After 3 months, we set sail on a ship that had wintered in the island, a ship of Alexandria with the twin gods as a figurehead. Putting in at Syracuse, we stayed there for 3 days. And from there, we made a circuit and arrived in Rugium. And after 1 day, a south wind sprang up. And on the second day, we came to Puteoli. There we found brothers and were invited to stay with them for 7 days. And so we came to Rome. And the brothers there, when they heard about us, came as far as the Forum of Appius and three taverns to meet us, on seeing them, Paul thanked God and took courage. Heavenly Father, we come to you this morning, Lord, and we continue to praise you. Father, may your word ring true. We know that it does not return void. Father, I pray that as we continue to worship, as we continue to dive in, Father, as we continue to invest, may our minds and our ears and our hearts continue to be open for what you have for us to learn today. God, may we not just sit and consume, but Father, may we consume to the point that we are overflowing and that we are changed. Heavenly Father, to the point where we want to take what we have learned and we want to share with those around us. Because Father, that is what we are called, that is what we are commanded to do. So Lord, I thank you. I thank you for each individual that is here. And God, I pray that you would bless them. Bless our time together. Bless and honor our time. I thank you for the praise team. I thank you for musical worship, Father God, leading us before the throne. Father, instill in us a 24/7 lifestyle of worship. Lord, we love you, we praise you, we give you glory and honor because you and you alone are worthy. For it's in your name, because all God's people said, amen. Amen. You can be seated. So here's the thought, verses 1 through 5. What do we see? We see shipwrecked, marooned, and snake bitten. See, Paul was shipwrecked, but we know that he was saved along with everybody else that was on that ship, so 270-odd men. We know that these men had been saved because when you go back and look, we saw this last week as Greg shared with us in chapter 27, that they had been saved from violent storms in verse 14. We know that most, or actually all of the men on board, except for Paul, had lost hope. We also know that they were going to attempt to abandon ship because of the storms that were coming up. And on top of that, there was a plan to kill all of the prisoners, but that was avoided, according to verse 42. And when you stop and think about it, again, when storms pop up, when trials rear their heads in our lives, just like they did in chapter 27 and what we're going to see in chapter 28, you and I need to be reminded, we need to remember that no matter what, no matter how little or how big, God is in control of those trials and he's in control of those storms. We don't need to take them out of his hands. Remember, Romans 8, 28. God works all things for the purposes of those who love him. See, Paul, God had promised to deliver Paul, right? Last time I checked, God didn't break his promises. And he's going to do it. But when you look through this passage, when you look through the part that we're looking at today, I mean, you go to verse 2 and you see, I mean, they've just been shipwrecked and they're coming out of the water. They're wet. They're cold. And on top of that, it's raining. You ever been there? Not shipwrecked. I mean, I don't know if anybody in here has been shipwrecked. But if you have, talk to me. I want another story. But I'm sure you've been wet. I'm sure you've been cold. And I bet it's rained on top of that, too, at some point in time. Okay? But then, now on top of that, you've got these that inhabit this island, and they are seen as barbarian because they don't speak the language. They're not native. So they're seen as uncivilized. So these that are on the island, they could have very well been threatened by these shipwrecked men. I mean, you've got 270 some odd, and all of a sudden you see all these that are floating in to the shore. But what we see here is it would appear to be the exact opposite. It would appear, I can imagine these that live on the island, they're actually going out into the water helping these prisoners get out of the water. All right. And really, they could have overtaken them. They probably could have plundered them for whatever they could have gotten from them. But they didn't. And you know why? Because God was protecting them. What they showed was kindness. The Greek word philanthropion, where we get our word philanthropy. But in the Greek, what this means, it's a love for mankind. It's the idea of reaching out. And then what we also see is that they started a fire. They knew these men were waterlogged. They knew they were cold. They knew they were wet. It's raining, so they start a fire to get warm. And let's face it, Paul's human. I wonder if he gets on shore, and I wonder if he thinks, even for just a moment, to himself, what else can happen? What else can go wrong? Have you ever been there? You ever thought that? You're in the midst of a storm. You're in the midst of a trial. And you think to yourself, can this get any worse? Can anything else happen? And let me ask you, has it happened? And what we see in verse 3 is, yep, it can. Verse 3, when Paul had gathered a bundle of sticks and put them on a fire, a viper came out because of the heat and fastened to his hand. At this point, I'd be done. Lord, take me now. I don't know about you. I don't mind snakes. I don't love them. You bite me, I'm done. I mean, here's Paul doing something innocent, trying to help out. He goes and grabs kindling sticks, puts them on the fire, and he grabs a snake. Or at least, we don't know if he grabbed or whatever, but he went to go put the wood on the fire, and a viper jumps out and attaches to his hand. Okay. Here's the thing. The other part of this is the fact that now it would appear, according to verse 4, that the natives are ready to turn on him. Because they're superstitious. They know that he's a prisoner. They know that he has escaped the sea. And they're convinced that this viper biting him is payback for everything that they think that he's done. In their culture, a snake bite was a bad omen. All right? And the phrase there in verse 4, no doubt, means that they were assuredly convinced he's done. He's done. Because justice was going to get him. But if you notice his reaction, it was simple and it was decisive. Verse 5 states, he, however, shook off the creature into the fire and suffered no harm. In a moment, he didn't panic. He didn't sit there and flail all over and take the chance of throwing it at other people and causing them distress or causing them issue. Excuse me. Neither did he do anything super spiritual. He didn't drop to his knees and call for an impromptu prayer meeting. He didn't throw out some crazy words or start preaching a sermon. He simply went about doing what he was doing. I mean, think about this. This man has been through storms. He's been through a shipwreck. This man has been beaten. This man has been stoned to the point of death. So we got a snake bite. I mean, I think about it this way. How many of us have asked the question, again, why? Why am I continuing to have trials? Why am I continuing to have storms? And I got to thinking about that very question. And I really thought about it this way, because here's the thing. There are times when we have trials. There are times when we suffer. And there are times when we have storms in our lives and we don't know why. And we also don't know why sometimes those things end in ways that we don't necessarily know why they ended that way. But here's what we do and should hold on to, is that God knows why. God understands. Because here's what I came to the conclusion of in accordance with God's word, is the fact that when we don't understand why, it's God's glory. Because those sufferings, those storms, those trials in our lives, how are they going to bring glory to God's name? Not only that, but he works things out for our good because he knows what's best. Not only that, it's his wisdom. He knows what we need, when we need it, and why we need it. Last time I checked, God knows better than we do. But he also shows mercy. He wants us to know his mercy. And he wants those around us to see his mercy. And he wants us to see it demonstrated. See, in this situation, with this viper bite, God demonstrated his glory and his wisdom and his mercy, because he took care of Paul. He's going to use this to reach more than these, what would be called, barbarians. He's going to use this to do that. Nothing happens by chance. Nothing happens by accident. Amen. And see, not even a snake bite was chance. This wasn't an accident. God is going to use this for greater glory and greater gospel proclamation. Just look at the next part. Verses 6 through 9. It's an opportunity for God's power to be shown. According to verse 6, they basically think that he's a god. But what they're going to be, what they will see, and what others on the island will now see, is the power of the one true God. Because they thought that Paul had gotten caught up by the gods of vengeance and justice, their superstition. Okay. I couldn't help but laugh at this, because here is Paul. He's gotten bit by a snake. a viper, shakes it off into the fire. And I wonder if he just sits back on the shore, grabs some marshmallows, starts roasting them, and him singing and humming some hymns. All while these islanders are staring at him. Like, when is this guy gonna swell up and die? They just keep watching him. He's just chilling. Literally, but nothing happens. And all of a sudden in their eyes, he goes from zero to hero. They basically thought he was a god. And see, when you don't have Christ in your life, when you don't have Jesus in your heart, there's instability in the human soul. There truly is. Because when you don't have Christ in your life, you can't understand changed lives. Radically changed lives. When you don't have Christ in your life, you don't truly understand healed bodies, made whole, unexplained. When you don't have Christ in your life, you don't truly understand circumstances triumphed over with power. Because what happens is people that don't understand, people that don't have Jesus Christ, miracles tend to disturb. They don't understand it. And so often what they do is they deny them or they try to explain them away and they try to grasp at everything that they possibly can except for the real reason, and that is God. That's what they try to do. And that's what we see here. But in the end, this is God. This is God taking care of Paul because he said that he would. And word spreads to the surrounding areas of where they are. And what we see is in verse 7. Now in the neighborhood of that place were lands belonging to the chief man of the island named Publius, who received us and entertained us hospitably for 3 days. See, God had used this trial, these trials, for his glory. And we see Paul's faithfulness throughout all of it. See, aren't we called to do the exact same thing that Paul has done? Yeah. I mean, even when it gets hard, even when the storms are difficult, even when the trials seem like we can't get through it, we don't know why these things have popped up. We don't know why we're going through them. Aren't we called to be faithful and see them through? Because we know that God is going to use them for his glory. 2 Timothy 2:8. Therefore, do not be ashamed of the testimony about our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share in suffering for the gospel by the power of God. See, here's something that is, as a pastor, it breaks my heart. As believers, it should break our hearts. But this is what happens in society a lot, especially in churches nowadays, unfortunately, is that when the going gets tough, faith takes a back seat at times. We turn our faith off. When really we should be relying on it even more. And see, here's the thing. Paul did not turn his faith on and off like a light switch. He stayed faithful no matter what. He stayed faithful through every circumstance and situation. And what we see in the following verse is that God used Paul. He displayed his power through Paul, allowing his purposes to be fulfilled, to share the gospel of Christ. Verse 8. It happened that the father of Publius lay sick with fever and dysentery, and Paul visited him and prayed, and putting his hands on him, healed him. They said that it's believed that what he had was something called Malta fever. It was a combination of fever and dysentery. And there's something that we see here when you break it down a little bit further. See, Paul laid his hands on the father and prayed for him, and he was healed. And the Greek word that is used here is iome, which is he was healed instantly. Now remember also that they were here for 3 months. And word was spreading about what was happening. The glory of God was spreading. And in verse 9, we see more that are coming. And they're coming because God is using Paul. And so more come to be healed. And there's a difference in these two healings. The word that is used in verse 9 is therapeo, which means that the healings happened over time versus instantly, because God's glory was being spread out. 3 months. You see, Paul could have mumbled. He could have groaned. He could have questioned why. But you know what he didn't do? Any of that. He was faithful. He was faithful because being faithful to God was the focus of his life. It truly was. He wasn't down. He wasn't defeated. He didn't question. He took the opportunity to share Jesus, to share the gospel. And it was because of this we see the inhabitants of the island of Malta taking care of Paul and the others as well. Because remember, God said he was going to watch over them. And he kept his promise. See, it's amazing to see that God can do anything if we give him everything, isn't it? Matthew 5:16 says, in the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father who is in heaven. So the last part of this passage, the journey continues. Verses 11 through 15. In verse 11, it says, after 3 months, we set sail on a ship that had wintered in the island, a ship of Alexandria with the twin gods as a figurehead. Now, we don't know if all 276 actually got on board on this ship. Could have just been Julius. It could have just been Paul and the centurion. It could have been a handful. We don't know. But we also don't know why Luke described in great detail, or better detail, about the front of the ship. But see, the twin gods on the front of the ship were believed to be good luck to sailors. They've been shipwrecked. Maybe why? I don't know. All I know is that they were named Castor and Pollux. They were the sons of Zeus. And then there was also the constellation Gemini, which was a sign of good luck in a bad storm. But here's the thing. I guarantee you there was one person that didn't even give any thought to that. Paul. He doesn't care. Because these details may have been included to contrast the superstitions with the true protection that the believers had, and that is God's providence. God's protection. In verses 12 through 13, we see a few stops. Syracuse was roughly about 90 miles. Then you have Rhegium, which was about 70 miles. Another 70 miles. And then you have Puteoli, which was roughly about another 210 miles. That's a lot of sailing. That's a lot of time on a boat. And I'm sure that Paul was probably getting a little bit apprehensive. I wonder if he was getting a little bit lonely. But I know without a shadow of a doubt when you read a little bit further that God was indeed providing. When you look at verse 14, it says, "There we found brothers and were invited to stay with them for 7 days." One thing to notice, do you see that there's no mention of soldiers or no mention of guards in chapter 28? Paul had become respected as a prisoner. So he had more freedoms as a prisoner than most. And see, we also know that there is a community of believers that was already in Puteoli. And if you go back to Acts chapter 18, we know this because the gospel had already reached Italy roughly sometime around AD 49. So the church had already been established long before Paul's arrival. And we see an invitation here. It conveys warmth. It conveys earnestness. To come alongside, the call to comfort, to beseech, an exhortation. And what we see in verse 15, that more came to visit from as far as the Forum of Appius and the three taverns, that they came to meet us. See, again, in the midst of all of this, God knew just what Paul needed. It says that when Paul saw the people, he thanked God for them. Look, he still had some 120 to 130 miles to go to actually get to Rome. And there were still others that would come to visit him. We don't know exactly who they were, but we know that they played a role because they were a constant encouragement to him. He's getting ready to fulfill what was told to him back in Acts 9. The last part of his journey to Rome that we're going to look at next week at the latter part of chapter 28. Again, he took courage. And see, we might not think much about this, but it gave him the courage that he needed. We think about the responsibility that you and I have as brothers and sisters in Christ to encourage one another. Hebrews 3:13, but exhort one another every day, as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. Church, we're called as brothers and sisters in Christ. We're called as a collective body to contribute to one another. The church needs you, and you need the church. That's what we see here from Paul in this part. See, as the ship inched its way to Puteoli, I'm sure that Paul was probably standing the bow, looking to both sides. I'm sure that he probably saw the Roman warships. He was probably taking in the entire scene. And you can't help but wonder what was going through his mind. He knows that God is going to use him. He knows that God is going to use him to do great things. But I'm sure that he couldn't help but wonder, what else is in store for me? What other new storms or trials are going to come up, even in the midst of God using me? How am I going to be received? But even in the midst of that, God was there. God was there because he said he would be. Romans 8:28, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. Would you bow with me? The beautiful thing is that God met the needs of his messenger. He met the needs of those that were at the seaport. He brought those there. He gave them 7 days together. There were more welcoming parties that came to encourage Paul. They traveled quite a distance to greet him. And they even traveled with him. But see, isn't that just like God? Isn't it just like God that in the midst of trials, in the midst of storms, in the midst of suffering, he's there? Just like Paul, for you and I, he's there. Now I'm reminded of the lyrics to a song. They go like this. It just says, because you were there. You were there. In the midst of danger's snare. You were there. You were there always. You were there when the hardest fight seemed so out of reach. You were there. You were always there. Listen, nothing could be more true. God is there. He's protecting you in all circumstances, in all situations, for his glory and for your good. So my question for you today is simple. Are you relying on him or yourself? I don't know what everybody in this room is going through right now. But God does. Maybe you're in the midst of a trial right now. Maybe you're walking through a storm right now. And my question for you is this: are you trying to do it on your own? Are you trying to do it by yourself? If you are, I want to encourage you. There's somebody that wants to walk with you and take it from you for His glory, for your benefit. His name is Jesus. If you've never experienced the power and love of Jesus Christ, there is nothing like it. Here in a moment, we're going to sing a song of invitation. I want to encourage you, if you've never come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, the saving love of Jesus Christ, the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning, the end, God, and they've never come to know you. Man, what a change that will make. But maybe there's a believer here today that is walking through a trial, that is dealing with a storm, and they've been trying to do it on their own. Maybe they don't even realize it. But God, maybe you're tugging on their heart and telling them, give it to me. Give it to me. Pray that they do. Lord, I pray that you would be glorified, that you would be honored in this invitation time. Continue to have your way with us. We love you. It's in your name. Let's stand together as we sing, church.
Calling on the God of Jacob, whose love endures through generations. I know that you will keep your covenant. I'm calling on the God of Moses, the one who opened up the ocean. I need you now to do the same thing for me. Oh God, my God, I need you. Oh God, my God, I need you now. How I need you now. Oh rock, oh rock of ages, I'm standing on your faithfulness. I'm children, you hear your children now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You answered prayers back then, and you will answer now. You are the same God. You are the same God. You were providing then. You are providing now. You are the same.
Let's worship together through your song.